Hello, welcome to Meet Me at the Movies. Noel T. Manning the Second here, coming to you from C19 TV. We appreciate you always spending time with us as we've gone through 500. You know, we're like, I don't know, not too far away from 550 episodes of this show, which is pretty dang amazing. And I have not been I've not been a part of all of those, but I've been a part of at least half of those, I think. Maybe I'm off. But anyway, I've been a part of them for a while. And if you have joined this show on occasion, you will have had a chance to meet Mr. Adam Long. Adam Long's a longtime friend. and also, we've been bringing him back monthly to talk about home delivery, to be able to look at what's happening for these home releases that you can check out, mostly what 4K, Blu-ray, and higher quality options is what we're talking about. Is that right, Adam? Am I getting that right?
You were correct, sir. You were correct.
Well, it's good to see you always, man. And we had you on only just a few weeks ago and talked about November and the December releases. Got all those caught up. It's a busy time in December and January. And now we're back in February talking about the January releases, and we'd love to get you to kind of dive in on those. We've got a 10 or a dozen or so. We'll see if we're able to get to most of those, and Oscar winners, and we've got some Stephen King related stuff, and also some SNL spinoff stuff as well. And also, I got to say, Uma Thurman is going to be making an appearance on the show. So, Adam, welcome. And we'll let you dive in with what's on your agenda. What's on the rundown for home releases that they can check out, our audience can check out?
Well, hello again. Thanks for having me on. We're going to do these alphabetically. Now, things did slow down a little bit in January, I will say. You're going to notice there's not quite as many, but, you know, there's still things to be had. And we'll start with an Oscar winner, a Best Picture nominee, actually. We have Coming Home. This is
Coming Home.
You know, from starring, and it was won Oscars for Jane Fonda and John Voight. They did win. And The Deer Hunter, obviously, was the Vietnam. There were competing Vietnam pictures that year. And this is more of a film about the effects of the war at home on the people, whereas The Deer Hunter was about. It was kind of sort of about that, but this is more so about the effects of, and Jane Fonda, her husband, Bruce Dern's in the, out there in the trenches, as it were. And at home, she develops a romantic relationship with John Voight, who's a paralyzed veteran. And it's a very tender, well-made film. There's a lot of really powerful scenes in the film. It was directed by Hal Ashby, one of the quintessential directors of the 1970s, of course, also famous for Harold and Maude and Being There with Peter Sellers, which was filmed in our backyard over here in Asheville at the Biltmore Estates. So, yes, and that was his next film after this, actually. So Hal Ashby directing this. And, yeah, this is just a great film with a lot of great performances. Bruce Dern is the husband of Jane Fonda in the film, and he, unfortunately, because they're performances are so powerful, he kind of gets overshadowed, and he gets to play his stereotypical crazy person there because he's the war is getting to him, right. But he does it so well. So anyway, Coming Home, you get an audio commentary here, a featurette, two featurettes actually, there you go. And this is a Kino Lorber release, and so, you know, Coming Home has been issued before. It's a reissue with a nice little slip case. I meant to show you that. That's one of the main draws in the new. And like I said, oops, there we go. We dropped it.
Yeah. So that's right. 1978. What a solid film. The cast just phenomenal. You mentioned quite a few of those, and Robert Carradine also shows up in this as well. And Robert Gidney makes an appearance as a Sergeant Dink, I believe, if I'm correct. But yeah, Coming Home. Just a great film. And, you know, and there were so many before this, you really didn't, I don't remember seeing a whole lot of films that covered that home front, what's happening there.
That's right.
And, you know, as someone who had a chance to talk to my grandmother, who was a wife and a worker during World War II, when my grandfather was battling, you know, the European theater, I mean, you're hearing her stories of what was happening at home. really made this movie come to life in different ways as well. And so I really kind of appreciated that. Now, of course, my grandmother didn't you know, fall in love with somebody else while she was here, but just that aspect of what's happening at home and the challenges you face at home, that was very, very real. So Coming Home, Kino Lorber release. What else you got, man?
Well, we'll move on to the Warner Archive, as they have issued A Day at the Races, the Marx Brothers film. This is one of the MGM films. You know, they did a series of films over at Paramount, and the money, they weren't bringing in the money they thought, so they canceled their contract at Paramount. And during a, I think it was a poker game with Irving Thalberg, who was the head of MGM, he offered him a contract, and so they started making films for MGM. They famously, the first one was A Night at the Opera, of course, and A Day at the Races was the follow-up. Personally, I lean towards the Paramount films. I think they're funnier and they're more, have more a sense of anarchy, I guess you would say. But still, having said that, any Marx Brothers film is going to have some funny set pieces, and A Day at the Races is no different in those terms, I think one of the things that hurt the MGM films was they have these musical sequences that go on, I think, way too long. Alan Jones, who's the father of Jack Jones, who sang the theme for The Love Boat, he is in both of these films, Night at the Opera and Day at the Races, and he gets his chance to belt out a few tunes, and so I think it slows down the pace of the film. This is a pretty long one, too, an hour and 51 minutes, whereas some of the Paramount films ran barely an hour and 10 minutes, so it's quite a... But, you know, there's some good stuff there, and you get a lot of extras here, a commentary, you get a making of featurette, you get some classic MGM cartoons from the period, audio-only treasures, just a theatrical trailer, and, you know, there's just all kinds of stuff here. So, and there's the back cover for anybody to... There you go. So A Day at the Races, getting the Warner Archive treatment. The picture quality is as good as you're ever going to find.
Awesome.
On that title. And yep.
1937 release.
Yes.
And also a cameo, uncredited cameo, Richard Farnsworth appears in the film as a jockey. So a little bit of trivia there for you as well. A Day at the Races.
I'm glad you brought that up. That's good. Good trivia. And yeah. That's an amazing to have a career that lasted from the 30s all the way through about to what, 1998 is when he passed.
Yeah,
I think.
So, yeah. Well, you know, SNL has had its share of talents who have gone on to the big screen and have gone on and done so many things. And you know, we'll remember Eddie Murphy, of course, who you know, found a way to parlay SNL into doing some stand up and some pretty raunchy stand up. And I remember. When the one we're going to talk about next was hitting theaters, and people were sneaking in because you know they were carding people, making sure that you were of age, 17 years old, before you could see this movie. And I remember a lot of my classmates who were not quite that age who found a way to sneak in to see Eddie Murphy live. Tell me about this release that people can check out.
Well, it's a Paramount release, and it is Eddie Murphy Raw, first time ever on Blu-ray. It's been available on DVD for many years, but never available on Blu-ray until now. There are no extras on this release, but it's directed by Robert Townsend, a comedian himself, and quite a good one.
Oh, yes.
He also did, what was the Hollywood Shuffle. That's the film he did.
Love that movie, yeah. Man. And also, I think he did The Five Heartbeats as well, didn't he?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. But who can forget breaking in at the movies on Hollywood Shuffle? I mean, great stuff. Yeah. And then you have a pre-concert sequence that shows supposedly Eddie Murphy as a child. That's quite funny, and I want to say maybe John Landis directed that part, but maybe I'm wrong about that. I can't remember. Maybe Townsend directed all of it, but anyway, it's you know, oh yeah, the sketch is co-written by Keenan Ivory Wayans, which is interesting. Around this time, but anyway, you know, it's a solid concert film. Some of it, you know. Some of it works better than other parts, but when he's doing what he does best, I mean, you can't, you know, it's a lot of great observational humor as he does. And, you know, certainly a lot of it won't fly with younger audiences today who are a little more sensitive to this sort of stuff.
Right.
But it was of a different time. So, no, I'm not, you know.
Yeah, and also the aspects of comedy, so much of it relates to pop culture and things going on within that time and time period as well. Not just the politically incorrect or politically uncorrect stuff, but the items that are relevant to that time. And I think one thing, anytime if you are able to watch or listen to comedy within a specific time period, it does give you a snapshot of what's happening then. It's really a historical stamp of what's happening and or what happened. And I think, if anything, that's one of the beautiful things about revisiting comedy from years gone by, is from that very standpoint of exploring history through comedy.
Absolutely. I would totally agree. Yes.
Awesome. Well, we gave a tease about Uma Thurman. So we got Uma Thurman, I think, coming up in our next home release for home delivery.
Here we go. This is Jennifer 8 with Andy Garcia. And this was a 1992 release. Paramount is issuing was the original studio that issued this. But this is a Scream Factory release as part of their licensing deal. The big selling point on this new release is that it includes two cuts of the film. It's an alternate cut of the film that's never been seen before. The film's directed by Bruce Robinson, who did With Nell and I, which is a cult following for a cult favorite for a lot of people, and How to Get Fired, or How to Get Fired, How to Get Ahead in Advertising. I'll get it out. So, but yeah, Andy Garcia was coming off of The Godfather Part 3 around this time. So his career was on the in internal affairs. His career was on the ascendancy, obviously. And, you know, it's John Malkovich. He's a serial killer. And Uma Thurman's a blind cellist who may be his next victim. And Andy Garcia is trying to put a stop to that and catch him before it's too late. So you get a new 4K scan of the original camera negative, two cuts of the film, as I said, with a never-before-seen alternate ending, a new retrospective with brand-new interviews with the director and stars, deleted alternate ending, original theatrical trailer. So Jennifer 8, and I don't think it's a perfect movie, but it's a solid movie. I enjoyed it, and I'm looking forward to revisiting it and seeing what this alternate cut might offer that's different. Because I heard about some studio meddling, so yeah.
Yeah, I think it's worth checking out, especially for those who love thrillers, because it is a film that I think kind of got lost in the shuffle of thrillers during that time period, during that era. But well worth checking out, and the cinematography was fascinating. Conrad Hall.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Won,
that's right.
I think, three Oscars. And if you think about his work on movies like Butch Cassidy and American Beauty and Road to Perdition, Cool Hand Luke. I mean, this guy's amazing. Yeah. And Marathon Man, I can't forget that. Guy's an amazing cinematographer, and he did work on this film as well. So you can check out Jennifer 8 for home delivery. And what's the studio that's releasing this again, Adam?
That's Scream Factory. Scream Factory right. release.
Awesome. Well, we're going to take a quick intermission right here on Meet Me at the Movies as we look at home delivery options that came out during the month of January that you can check out now through various means. So stick around after this quick intermission. We're going to come right back. We've got quite a bit more to talk about, including a bunch of roaches, and then maybe you need to find some pest control folks to help you out. So stick around right after this quick intermission. We've got more.
Won't you come and meet me at the movies? Won't you come and watch a flick?
At CCC, we're all about training students for exciting careers. Our Barber Academy is a great example. Did you know jobs for barbers, stylists, and other related fields are increasing? Competition for the best jobs will be strong. With your CCC training, you'll have a definite edge. Our courses give you the skills and knowledge you need to sit for North Carolina's Apprentice Barber exam. To move up the ladder, you need at least 1 year of on-the-job training before you take the state's registered barber exam. If you pass, it's official. You'll be a registered barber. While private barber schools can cost $10,000 or more, CCC makes it affordable. Plus, you can complete our Barber Academy in only 15 months. Now the question is, are you ready to start your journey today?
These lines, like the creases in my father's hands, show the hard work and sacrifices of a line worker. These lines are the connections my father helped build between people businesses, and organizations. They tell the story of how we invested in ourselves. We're public power, and these lines are our lines.
Won't you come and meet me at the movies? Won't you come and watch a...
Welcome back to Meet Me at the Movies. Noel T. Manning the second here, and I've got like Alexa talking to me in the background. Don't even know what she's saying or why she's wanting to share stuff with me. Maybe she's saying tune in to C19 TV or WGWG and check out Meet Me at the Movies each week. Adam Long, our guest right here, and we're talking home delivery for things that were released in January. Some Blu-ray for the first time, some 4K. Adam, we're diving in, man. Let's talk about roaches and maybe are roaches ever good to have in your home? Tell me about this, man. Tell me about it.
I'm definitely voting against having them in the home if possible. Having a film about them is about as close as I want to come. But this is Joe's apartment. This is a film I never thought would get released on Blu-ray. I'm a huge fan of this film. I thought it got terrible reviews for the most part when it came out. It was based on an MTV short. It's Jerry O'Connell. He basically moves into an apartment and finds out that he's got that it's inhabited by roaches, and so he has to learn to coexist with them. And there are all these musical sequences that are done Busby Berkeley style, where the cockroaches have a Busby Berkeley number in a toilet bowl and that type of stuff. And you know who you are in terms of the audience for this sort of thing. But I found it to be just endlessly funny, endlessly witty. I laughed from start to finish. It's a breezy 80 minutes. And it was just only available in the old Snapper case, the old Warner Brothers Snapper case. It was released in 1998 on DVD and never reissued until now. And it was just, it looked terrible. It was a terrible, it was even a, like a, it wasn't even a widescreen transfer, but now they've done such a great job on this. And you get some new Warner Brothers cartoons. Well, not new Warner Brothers cartoons, but classic Warner Brothers cartoons. There's several of those as a bonus material. And the original theatrical trailer, like I said, this didn't do very well when it came out, but I think it's very, very witty, very funny, and you could do a lot worse with 80 minutes of your time than Joe's apartment there. And
absolutely.
You know, yeah, and what other film are you going to find that has a Don Ho in it as a as a thug, you know? So
I'll mention cinematography again. I did that before the break, and Peter Deming, cinematographer for this. He's worked with people like Sam Raimi and David Lynch, Wes Craven. Back in 2002, he won an award for his cinematography on Mulholland Drive, which was just beautiful.
Yeah, it is.
The cinematography is not something you typically would think about in Joe's apartment, but he definitely puts his stamp on that as well. And just a fun film, like you said, it's 80 minutes of just pure insanity, but it's worth it. One of our buddies, I think, Douglas Davidson, is a huge fan of this movie, so I'm sure that he's excited to have this in his home. Well, what you got next on the rundown, buddy?
Well, we've got next here is another Kino Lorber release. It's a film that I had always wanted to see, and it was kind of, I think MGM put a DVD out of it years ago, went out of print, really kind of hard to find, and they did a 4K restoration on it. The Outside Man from 1972, and this has an amazing cast. It's Jean-Louis Trintignant, who was in A Man and a Woman and became an international star. He's a French actor and was recently in, what was that film he was in about 10 years ago? It's about a couple that's having, the wife has cognitive issues and her quality of life is going down, and he's faced with the decision of what to do about that. And I can't remember. It was got really good reviews. I'm sure people can Google that and find out what it was. But anyway, Anne Margaret is also in this. Roy Scheider, Angie Dickinson, just an amazing cast. And it's essentially about a hitman played by Jean-Louis Trintignant. And he's hired to assassinate. He comes from France to Los Angeles to carry out an assassination. He does. And Roy Scheider is sent to kill him. He figures out it's a setup. And so Roy Scheider, and it's so great because it captures the 1972 Los Angeles in a way that is just, it's really wonderful how they, you get a sense of the time and the place. I even saw there's a chase scene where the poster for the movie The Other, which we all know I'm a big fan of, is visible in the background. But it's just a, like I said, it's just a solid, you know, gangster thriller, I guess you would say.
Yeah.
And it's a good transfer. The unfortunate part is that the original theme song that is called The Outside Man is missing from this version, which I don't understand. Maybe it's a rights issue or something.
Yeah. But that normally is what happens when that's the case. It's normally a rights issue.
And the color scheme is a little bit different from the DVD in comparison to this. Has more of a greenish tinge to it, I would say, but it's still good looking. It's sharp enough, and so and it's, you know, it's at least it's out there and available where it was hard to find before. But The Outside Man, directed by Jacques Duret, he was a French director, and so it's got several commentaries too. I failed to mention, and two cuts of the film. So
yeah, and it's a film that also did well in France because of the French director as well, and a couple of other. If you keep your eyes open, you might see Talia Shire showing up in this as a makeup girl, and Jackie Earle Haley.
Yes, I forgot about him.
Which we all, you know, if you go back to the original Bad News Bears, he's done other things too. But yeah, so those are a couple of other names to throw out there.
Georgia Engel. Well, I forgot about her from Mary Tyler Moore Show. We all remember her. She was the squeaky voiced blonde, and
Well, we talked earlier about a comic talent by the name of Eddie Murphy. Well, there's another comic talent that of course predates Eddie Murphy, Rodney Dangerfield, who found a way to parlay his stick, where, you know, he never gets respect, into a few film appearances. And there's one he took on an animated film appearance and actually got to use his name in the title of the film.
That's right. Another Warner Archive release. It's Rover Dangerfield. And this is another one that's been really needing a Blu-ray upgrade. This was originally conceived as an R-rated comedy, cartoon, R-rated animated comedy is what I was getting at. But I think the folks at Warner Brothers decided they didn't want to go that route. So they had him tone down some of the more adult material, and it went and put it out there as a G-rated film, where unfortunately came and went within just a matter. It only made several hundred thousand dollars at the box office. The box office take was terrible on this. It's animated by the same people who did The Brave Little Toaster, if we any of us remember that. So the animation is the same, those same folks. And, you know, it's got the good, it's got some, you know, some obviously cleaner, more family-friendly one-liners from Rodney Dangerfield, who voices the dog of the film's title. And, you know, it's a fun little movie. It has a story that was developed by Dangerfield and Harold Ramis, which is an interesting collaboration. I would have preferred to have seen the full R-rated version. I think it probably would have done better that way. But because this was, I think, his first film after Back to School. So everybody was excited to see what he was going to do next. And then this just didn't quite make the grade. But it's out there now, thankfully. There are a couple of Warner Brothers cartoons as extras there. Right. So Rover Dangerfield.
Awesome. Well, let's talk about a film that's satire. We talked about SNL, and there's the beauty of satire and parody. And this film won a couple of Golden Globe Awards for Best Picture, Musical or Comedy, and also Best Actor. For a guy by the name of Alan Arkin.
That's right. We're talking about The Russians Are Coming. The Russians Are Coming. And obviously the title tells all, where Alan Arkin is one of those Russians, and Carl Reiner is a family man. He's married to Eva Marie Saint, and he finds out that he finds his house being besieged by these Russians, and all comedy breaks loose, as they say. Hilarity ensues. It doesn't quite hold up as well as maybe it did when it came out. I rewatched it. The transfer is good. This is a reissue of a previous transfer that Kino Lorber had put out. Interestingly enough, I watched it, and the very next day, or maybe the day after that, the director of the film passed away, Norman Jewison.
Wow. So we lost him. That's right.
And this was his, I think, feature film debut, or at least one of the early ones that got his name out there. The next year he did In the Heat of the Night, which won Best Picture of the Year, of course. So, and there's a featurette with Norman Jewison and an audio commentary with film historians here, Michael Schlesinger and Mark Evanier. So, the Russians Are Coming, Russians Are Coming is, it's a film that should be seen because of its place in cinematic history. Like I said, doesn't quite hold up maybe as well as it did at its time, but there are moments, as they say.
Yeah. I remember it being a fun film to watch for sure. I of course watched it later than its release date. It was released in 1966, so I saw much later. But at that time, it worked. So I'm still interested in going back to check it out. Well, Adam, sure. We've got just a couple minutes, and I know you've got two more on the list, including a Stephen King adaptation.
Yeah, I do. And that would be Thinner, which is directed by Tom Holland, who made Fright Night and Child's Play. And this was this is essentially Robert John Burke playing a lawyer who gets cursed. He's a rotund lawyer, let's say. He gets cursed, and the curse is that he will continue to lose weight until there's nothing left of him. And so he has to try to find a way to reverse the curse, as it were. And he's got a cheating wife he's got to deal with, all that. And so it's, but there's some pretty interesting makeup effects here. I think this has a new audio commentary, new featurettes, behind the scenes stuff about the makeup. It's a Scream Factory release. So Thinner.
The last one on your list, man.
Yeah, we got Varsity Blues from, this is from 1999. And this is first time ever in 4K with James Van Der Beek. He was big on, he was coming off of Dawson's Creek around that time and breaking into films. And he's a star athlete, has no time for the coach. And he's got all kinds of stresses and pressures and temptations being a star athlete and trying to deal with all that stuff. And you got John Boyd in there. And so, this, like I said, there's no, I don't think there are any new extras. It's the director, Brian Robbins, gives a commentary, joined by the producers, and there's a making of featurette. But Varsity Blues, and very quickly, very briefly, another Kino Lorber release. I got this in the mail after we talked, before we decided what we were going to do. The Boogans from 1981, which is a film that turned up on HBO quite a bit. Great transfer on this. It's about miners, and they unearth these creatures that live in the mines, and they start terrorizing people. And I know Stephen King was a big fan of this one, and first time ever in 4K. If you're a fan of the Boogans and you remember HBO in the early 80s like we do, you might want to think about that one too. So
yeah, it sounds like the kind of stuff that happens in my backyard all the time. You know, people trying to scare you, freak you out, and then you realize it's only Thomas. It's my son, Thomas. So, Adam, man, we appreciate you spending time with us each month and giving us home delivery options. We appreciate what you've shared with us for the January releases. I look forward to having you back next month as well. And thanks to all you who take the time to spend with us, whether that's through C19 TV or through WGWG. We really do appreciate it. We invite you to check out Adam's work on Adam's Corner on YouTube, and just continue to follow our work as well. And we'll share it and respond to comments at info@c19.tv. So for Meet Me in the Movies and for Adam Long, I'm Noel T. Manning II. And for this week, that is a wrap. And the bad ones, many films to view till we meet again.